Welcome to Oyate Today. Oyate in Lakota means people. Brought to you by Native Sun News Today.
Hi, welcome to Oyate Today. I'm your host, Richie Richards. Oyate Today is produced by Tim and Jackie Gallego. Tim is an enrolled member of the Oglala Sioux Tribe. Our guest tonight is Mr. Sequoia Crosswhite, local musician from Rapid City here and a culture bearer. And I'm just glad to have you here, sir.
Well, thank you for having me.
This is going to be a good discussion. I know that you've been doing some great work, and I've seen you around at different shows. So thank you so much for taking time to come here.
Thank you.
Sequoia, tell us a little bit about yourself and some of your background and history.
Well, I grew up here in Rapid City. I'm an enrolled member of the Cheyenne River Sioux Tribe. I'm a descendant of two chiefs, Chief War Eagle and Chief Swift Cloud. And I've been a cultural relations advisor out at Children's Home for going on 13 years. Just raising up here as a young child, I wasn't necessarily aware of my native heritage. Then I had somebody when I was really little call me a dirty, lying thief and Indian. Mm-hmm. And then I realized I was Indian. And then I had another circumstance where I played at another friend's house, and my mother came to pick me up. And after my mother picked me up, I was not allowed to go over that child's house anymore. Mm-hmm. And so I battled with a lot of that things, not knowing that, but then realizing that my unchi was Lakota from Cheyenne River gave me pride, and it showed me another side of myself to persevere, to have that wachin tonka, that fortitude to keep going.
Mm-hmm. And I noticed you're speaking Lakota words. Where did you learn that at?
My grandmother spoke Lakota at home, but when I was really little, she would teach us certain words like apple, taspan, and maybe banana, zishkopala, and stuff. But later on, I got a desire for the language in my teenage years. I started to go to ceremonies down in Porcupine with Lekshi Rick Two Dogs, and I was adopted into the horse family down there, and picking up the language there and just made me think about how this is important to keep this alive. And then that led into learning my own family history and not knowing that how much language and communications played a part in my family's history. My great-great-grandfather was Andrew Traversy. Mm-hmm. And he was 14 years old when he went to Washington, D.C. with Chief Hump and served as an interpreter for him. And it said that he spoke three languages. He spoke Lakota, French, and English.
Wow.
And it was always his goal was to maintain his communications, because that was the biggest or the root of all relationships, was to have good communications.
And so he was there with Chief Hump.
That's 14 years old.
That's pretty special. At 14 years old, knowing three languages.
Yep.
That's pretty amazing. What's your current? I know you mentioned your current position, but what do you do out there at the?
Children's Home
Children's
Society.
Home, yeah.
Yep. At Children's Home, I work as a cultural relations advisor, and being a cultural relations advisor means that I do cultural trainings for the new staff that come in, and I do annually cultural trainings for the staff that are there. I also do cultural activities and trips with the children, and then on a weekly basis, I teach the children Lakota culture and Lakota language. Mm-hmm. And it's not just the native students. I work with all the students, all of my students, no matter what background they come from, they're all going to receive some Lakota language and some Lakota culture.
What would be an example of one of those trips then? Where do they visit? Where do you guys go to?
The last trip, I took the kids out to Peshla out there and kind of talked the story, the history of that bald spot in the middle of the Black Hills and the significance of Hesapa and how it is to our people in Oyate. Mm-hmm. And so that would be an example of there to go outside to experience nature. Mm-hmm. You know, Luther Standing Bear said it a long, long time ago that a man's heart away from nature becomes hard. So mm-hmm. the goal for cultural significance is to be out there where it is significant, which is in nature.
Sure. And that type of work has to be rewarding, obviously, working with children and youth and males and females and such. Is there a special individual or a group of individuals that you're really proud of having that moment with then?
There's many, 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 many blessings. I guess one example is one of the boys I worked with the first year I was there. ended up graduating high school, and he came back to Children's Home and wanted to work there, and is doing very good for himself and pointed in the right direction. Another great example is I had like a non-native kid, and his parents came to visit him. And when I open up my class, I always ask the kids three questions: what's your name, what are you, and how old are you? And so this little boy in particular wanted me to ask those three questions in front of his parents to show that he could speak Lakota language, even though he never was taught that at home.
Wow, awesome. Why did you choose this field? And obviously working at a children's home has to be, you have your good moments, but also there's challenging moments. Moments and those tough moments. So why did you choose to get into this field then?
Well, I guess, you know, I have to give it up to the Creator. The Creator works in mysterious ways. I was doing cultural presentations since about 17. I started off here at Prairie Edge.
Oh, wow.
Playing flute for tourism when we used to have the powwow in July. And then my name was kind of spread out, and I've always wanted to be a performer and a musician. And so for the longest time, I kind of did the cultural performance on side, and I would do music on the other side. Well, seeking after my dream of being a musician, I went out to New York, and I did some good gigs and made some good contacts, but realized that it's really expensive out there.
Sure.
And so that gave me the decision to come back home and go to school. And so I graduated from Ogallala Lakota College with a language certificate and a degree in Lakota studies. So if I was going to continue in tourism, that I would have this on my background. And it just happened to be one of my cousins was working out at Children's Home, and this position opened up as a cultural relations. And so I applied and I sought after it and calling the CEO nonstop, thinking this is exactly what would be for this degree that I have.
Sure. And so you mentioned starting off at Prairie Edge here. What happened anyway? How did you get your start?
Well, I tell the story all the time, but it's pretty much a true story. I walked in and I was just wandering around with some cousins of mine, and I asked Rose downstairs if I could look at a certain flute. And she kind of gave me a concerned look, saying, well, yeah, you can look at it, be very careful with it. Pretty much tell me not to play it. But as soon as she turned her back around, I started to play it. And then I get tapped on the shoulder by the manager, Dan Tribby, and I think I'm in trouble for playing this flute. And he actually asked me if I was able to do flute performances. And I said, I've never done one before, but I'm a ham for attention, so I will. And the truth be told, too, is I didn't have a very good flute when I started playing. So my first flute performance ever was to earn a flute from here at Prairie Edge.
And was that through that experience?
Yeah, that was through that experience.
Did you play flute before that then?
I played clarinet. I've been playing clarinet since I was in fifth grade. And my godmother, Lindy Williams, not Lindy Williams anymore, but my godmother Lindy, she had given me a flute, and so I learned how to play with it and started to pick it up. But, you know, it was a good enough flute to start practicing with.
Yeah.
But then the flute that I performed for here at Prairie Edge, I still have to this day.
Has it always been native music then?
It started off with native music, and now it's worked into its contemporary style. Mm-hmm. I feel that our music, whether it would be with the drum or with the flute or singing, that you keep it alive by bringing it into the contemporary world.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned a little bit earlier about identity and self-identification as far as, you know, the youth that you work with and people that you've come across. Have you had any issues with any of this as far as identity and self-identifying with?
You know, still to this day, after all these years I've lived, I still battle with that within myself, thinking, do I have enough blood? Am I enough Indian to present to do these things? And I'm always reminded by what my grandma would always say, that if you have this much Lakota blood in you, you are a Lakota. And so that keeps my pride along and keeps me moving towards. But I also acknowledge and realize that there is so many individuals out there, male and female, that are like myself, who are very light skinned, but have tribal ties. And some of them are dealing with a lot of mental issues and different things within their personal selves. And I can say from my personal experiences, learning my culture, learning about where I come from, to know that this traumatic stuff happened to my grandparents and things, led to me feeling these anxieties and these insecurities, helped me realize that was where the root came from. And so if I can learn where that root is, I can pull it out and try to help out so we can heal.
Sure. I guess that was going to be my next question is, do you have advice, say, for one of our audience members, one of our viewers or one of the youth that you work with? What kind of advice do you give them if they're dealing with those same type of, you know, inner, I guess, insecurities or whatever the case may be, anxieties or however?
You know, I many different things. I use music, and then especially finding who my family was, learning my family's background, learning my family tree, learning those things. I'm also a practicer of yoga, and doing some physical exercises to actually stimulate those things. And in our practices of Mblecha and doing our ceremonies and stuff like that, getting into our spiritual side has helped out so much. But there's many who are who don't look like they're native, but are native and don't realize that they too suffer from those historical traumas that came back. Even though it doesn't show on their skin, it's still in their mind.
Definitely, and in their hearts. Somewhere.
And in their hearts, yes.
Definitely. Sequoia, we're going to take a break. You know, you bring up a really good point, because there's a lot of people who you know, have shunned that part of them, or their family has shunned that part of them. It's just shameful that we have to be in that part of this discussion with that. But we'll be back after a short break.
Closed captioning for Oyate Today is brought to you by Black Hills Energy.
Native Sun News has been voted the best weekly newspaper in its class for 2015 by the South Dakota and North Dakota Newspaper Associations. You can find a copy of the Native Sun News at many businesses and vending machines in Rapid City and the surrounding area, and on all 9 reservations. We publish every Wednesday so advertisers and subscribers can reach our diverse readership by calling 605-721-1266. The Native Sun News covers the other side of the story.
You can't predict life's ups and downs. You just give it all you've got to stay on top. But it's easier with a partner like Security First Bank. Since 1898, we've been riding with you through the country's biggest ups and downs. And this is where we'll stay. Security First Bank, a relationship you can count on. Member FDIC.
Look into my eyes, you will see what you mean to me. Don't tell me it's not worth trying for. You know it's true. Everything I do it for you.
Hi, welcome back to Oyate Today. Once again, our guest tonight is Mr. Sequoia, Crosswhite. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
You're a really interesting gentleman. I really enjoyed our discussion, so thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for the work you're doing with the youth. That's very important for all of us.
Thank you, sir.
All of us across the board. You're very passionate about music, and I can tell that music is a part of your soul and your spirit and who you are. What role does this music that you're taking on and that you've been playing, what role does that play in healing, I guess, for kind of the work you're doing, or maybe for yourself? And is music even kind of a healing part of your life then?
Music is 100% healing for me. I feel that the Creator gave me a gift through music to express myself and try to actually use it as an outlet for teaching as well. And then as far as the healing goes, it's a universal language. So within the tones, it doesn't have to be a word that is spoken from a human mouth. It just can be a tone that can affect somebody's mood. Mm-hmm. And it's scientifically been proven that certain tones and certain things will change people's mood, either inspire them or make them feel down or make them feel up. Mm-hmm. And bringing those colorful things, then not only are you in your own little community, but then that music can project across the world because it's universal.
Mm-hmm. And when you're talking about projecting across the world, you also play the music for the youth at your job then.
Right, exactly.
And so what kind of reaction, because I'm sure that some of these youth have their challenges. They've
yes.
had challenging lives. They come from challenging backgrounds and homes and things like that. And God bless them for everything they're going through. But I'm sure that this music has some impact on them. Have you seen that impact? And what type of impact?
I've seen a very positive impact on it. Showing the kids that through my struggles and through my background, because I had such a rough childhood, in and out, you know, I definitely had great people in my life, but it was a rough journey getting there, but showing them that through my trials and tribulations that I use music to express myself, to get out maybe these anger issues that are inside, or maybe these exciting issues or these sad issues, depending on the emotions of it. But showing that this is a way that a lot of us have energy built up in it, and how do we project it? And a lot of times if we keep that built up, then it comes out negatively. But if we can use that energy in a positive sense, then it can come out, you know, good and healing. And I've watched over the years, and even right now, I have some students that are wanting me to get up there to help them write on songs because they're starting to work on songwriting.
Wow, isn't that special?
Yes.
Definitely. And so they're interested in the same, like the instruments that you play then?
Yeah, not only just the same instrument, but just in music in general. And I find is that the hip-hop, I love hip-hop. I love all genres of music. I love heavy metal, love country, classical, everything. But I found within hip-hop that it incorporates all these genres into one. So, and not only just genres, but also ethnic instruments. So within that, you can bring in an instrument from Africa, instrument from Asia, or a Lakota flute, and blend it in and put it behind a beat that makes it contemporary. And then, and knowing that this hip hop music is what kids motivate them, and it is kind of a youth driven style of music. And it originally came out as a positive way to talk about the hardness that is in the inner cities with the poor communities. And so to express that original hip hop positively, to get that out, that we can use this not only through the music, but the dance, and then within writing rhymes, which is also poetry and expression through words.
Yeah, it's almost like expression is a form of healing. Expression is healing then in many ways, because a lot of them turn to poetry or writing or like you said, dancing or singing or whatever the case may be, music and things like that. So you giving them this opportunity to kind of expand that or explore that is a really great thing for our community in a big way. So I appreciate that very much so. In that sense, do you think that this style of music, and we'll have you play a little later, which is going to be awesome, but do you think that there's a spiritual element to what you're doing with this music?
Definitely. I really do think it's a spiritual element, and that element is to show the inevitable law of love, that everybody needs love. And not only that, but also to show, to break down barriers, and how expressing that, you know, it doesn't need to be this type of person to do this type of music, and it doesn't need to have a negative message to say what is going on, to show that, hey, I'm using these words, I'm using this music in a positive way. It might sound negative because you don't understand what's coming on, but it's coming out as a positive thing to basically open people's minds and bring people together, because mitakuye oyase, we are all related. And I guess that would be the second message of my music, is to show how much we are really all related.
And evidence of that is the fact that you've traveled around the world and expressed this localized, this Lakota version of music, and taken it across and around the world. So where all have you played at then?
I played in Austria and Germany and in Switzerland, and then I played quite a few places around here in the United States. I just finished a gig down in Louisiana at the Lafayette International Festival.
Wow, I bet that was fun.
Oh, it was amazing, and it was an international festival, so there was groups from Africa, groups from Guatemala, groups from Asia, groups from Turkey, the Middle East, groups from Belgium. So you had not only this contemporary style representing, but you also had all these tribal entities representing through these music. And really the my basis as a teaching is that to show that no matter what skin color we are really all basis from a tribal group.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and
definitely,
we're all tribal people. So that means that we're all native from somewhere as well.
Definitely. Now you have three albums out, and I just wanted you to kind of briefly talk about each one and tell
sure.
us, you know, where it came from and things like that for
sure.
you from you.
Right. So this is my first album. This is Waknuka Ulawa, which is Woodpecker Song. This was inspired by a good friend of mine that was working at Children's Home. Vernon Ella Schaefer is their names. I got to give him a shout out. We're sitting in the office, and I gave him a copy of my flute music. And he says, what would it take for you to get that out there? And I said, well, I need about $1,500 to get a CD made. And long story short, he lent me the money. The only deal was is that I had to have his daughter do the artwork. So the artwork on my first album here was painted by Vern's daughter, Katie Rose Schaefer. And so from this first album, It took off a little bit. I thought maybe, you know, maybe it won't go anywhere or it won't do anything. And it came out in 2009. And since then, it's been featured in two travel channel shows, Raw Travel and Born to Explore. And it's been used as a soundtrack for Lakota Girls.
That's awesome. That's awesome. And your second album?
My second album, and this is all, the first one's all flute, and the second album is all flute. This is Hey Sapo with Chakpi Olawan, which is a Black Hills Star song. And this is a compile, knowing that that I had these songs come together and really inspired by my work that I've done with CIRNS, which is the Center American Indian Research and Native Studies, and the different compositions I've done for them. And I thought, well, I've got these together. Why don't I add them all together and come up with another album? And so I came up with this album, and I'm very thankful that I had a good friend of mine, Evans Flamin Sr., down in Pine Ridge, who did the artwork for it.
Awesome. Awesome. Evans is awesome, too.
Yeah.
And your most current album, Grandma's Boy. Tell us a little bit about it. And actually, we're going to have a song from this album after our break here.
That's right. So, you know, through my childhood, I was very thankful to have all the family that I did involved with me. But one of that really inspired me and shaped me into the individual I am today was my grandmother. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother took me around, and I was her little man, her little date, taught me how to open up doors for ladies and how to be respectful and all those things. And also, through all the trials and tribulations that I had, different experiences, maybe disagreements with my father. So my grandma always supported me with my music. She always was there. And I lost her about a year and a half ago. And I just wanted to put out an album to dedicate to her. And just so people are aware of, the next album coming out is going for my mom, because I just lost her a few months ago. And so the next album, I have Grandma's Boy, and then we got Mama's Boy coming
out.
That's
awesome. Thank you for honoring the backbone of our society. We'll be back after a short break.
I have a dream. I want to be a soldier.
I have a dream. I want to be a construction worker.
You can help kids' dreams come true by donating to Rural America Initiative's Building Fund.
I used to think news is news. It's all the same, but it's not. There's a big difference between local broadcast news and cable news. See, local stations are part of my community, connecting me to local news, weather, and sports on every device. It makes sense. Get the news from the people I trust who actually live here. No agenda, no bias like on cable shout shows or social media, just facts. For news I can trust, I stay local. Support your local stations. Text TV to 52886 today.
Sometimes one moment changes everything. One song, one game, one mission. Support Make-A-Wish and help grant more life-changing wishes at wish.org.
Hi, welcome back to Oyate Today. Once again, our guest tonight is Mr. Sequoia Crosswhite. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you so much.
It's been
for
a good
me.
Discussion, and I'm really proud of the work you're doing, and especially with the youth. You know, it's very important to engage and bring out their positive energy. So thank you so much. I understand you want to play a song for us tonight, and this is awesome. So this song is actually called The Only Thing. It's from Grandma's Boy, the album that we had just seen previously.
Yeah.
And it was released in February of 2019. Where can we go to find your albums then? Is there somewhere we can send traffic to?
Sure. Yes, please look me up. Just Google my name and you'll find me on Spotify, Pandora, iTunes, all the major different digital libraries that are out there. You can find my releases on there.
Awesome. I'm not going to say no more. Do your thing, brother.
Okay. This song's called The Only Thing I Need, and the only thing I really need is love, and that's what we all need. So just a little expression of love here for y'all.
Do it.
The only thing I need in this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? Whoa, whoa, whoa. The only thing everything I need. In this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? The only thing I need in this world is my son and my baby girls. A song and rhyme to ease my mind, to help me get through these hard times that come my way. Day to day with the bills I pay, I gotta make sure that my family's got a place to stay. Cause you know it's cold outside, need gas for the ride. It's my baby girls that I can't deny. Gotta give them a better life than the one I had. Hopefully they understand it's trying to be their dad. And I'm the only thing I need in this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? Whoa, whoa. The only thing I need in this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? The only thing I need in this world. The only thing I need in this world. Yo, would you care to listen about my living conditions? My answered prayers for all those not to wish wishing to have a home on my own with a couple of children. Depending on my own, I mean that good life living. Being a man with a plan to always be driven. Do the best in this world, to always be giving no matter what I do. I always stand for what's true on the stage or the classroom or hanging with my crew. What I'm going through, love will come my way. You get down with open ears to the words I say. Family life for me is the only way to help me push on each and every day. So come on. The only thing I need in this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? The only thing I need in this world is love. So people, would you care to listen? What you be doing?
I want to thank our producers. I want to thank our sponsors. I want to thank Mr. Sequoia Crosswhite for the work he's doing. And I want to thank Prairie Edge for hosting our show tonight. And I want to thank you for making Oyate Today a part of your night.
Thank you so much.
You've been watching Oyate Today, brought to you by Native Son News Today.